it's distant, and it is usually instantaneous, often instantaneous. How the dickens can that happen? So we were looking at that, and we found first that there's hundreds, thousands of research papers written. Forget the empirical fact. People have been healed. They're not stupid. They go to the shaman because he does the healing. But in this country, Mary Baker Eddy, Florence Nightingale, the most important healers in Europe and in America, never been recognized and kind of despised. And the archives of the United States took out all the records of Mary Baker Eddy's healings, and they had to restore them. They didn't even want to write about it. They thought it was so stupid. But now it's turning out, oh, it wasn't so stupid, and we had cheated. Again, the cheating. Archivists of the United States admitted to the fact that generations ago, the archives of the United States took out every reference. Why? The fact that she could have been wrong, but you record it. An archive is the truth. William James, the great philosopher, great American philosopher, Harvard professor, he was very interested in spiritism. In the completed works of William James from Harvard University, they dropped all reference to that. This was a third of his life, a third of his work. They took it out. So now, who is cheating here? What are they afraid of? So there is, in a sense, a deathly fear of the spiritual dimension. Why? In the Bible, Jesus talks about healing. There's a lot of healing in the Bible. Jesus heals people. The disciples heal people. All through every religious tradition, there has been spiritual healing going on. It's a tremendous challenge to everybody. So now, most of the Western world, since the so-called Enlightenment, which could be called a diminishment, because it reduced people into bodies only, since then, people said this can't work, so we just ignore it. But now it's made a big comeback. We have practices, we have groups meeting, we have this German group of 6,500 German-speaking physicians in Europe banded together to do spiritual healing because they see it working. They're not idiots, they're in their practices and they're doing spiritual healing, encouraging their patients to do this. We're seeing this research cadre, Dr. Larry Dossey, editor of a journal, turning out books upon books with the research and saying, look, here it is, you can do with it what you want. So the re-emergence of the power of spiritual healing is the biggest single hope, not only a challenge to medicine, it is the biggest single adjunct to healing that we are likely to see. So there's a lot of learning there, and I look at that as an enormously hopeful thing for real healing to take place. Now, that does not mean that there's no place for all the great stuff that we've done in Western medicine. If you have a strong insult, something breaking bone in a car accident, don't go looking for Chinese herbs. That's what Andrew Weil says. Don't go to the emergency room if you can get in. But that's what Western medicine is very good for: strong attacks, strong fevers, broken bones, something terrible. It's marvelous, and it's pretty much engineering. It's our business. Surgery has nothing to do with medicine. Nothing. It's pure engineering. And it's exquisite, and it's wonderful. So enormous advantages which Western medicine has brought. So those must be attached to all the stuff which spiritual healing can do, free. And the most important thing that spiritual healing can do is to deal with reality. Humans are going to die. They're not going to live forever. Therefore, we should have a good death. Dying is the key issue for saving American medicine. If we could teach people to, like their grandparents and their great-grandparents and history, all, you have to prepare to die. Prepare to die. It's the art of dying. Ars moriendi. What is the art of dying? How should you get ready for dying? about 25 to 30% of the total cost of Medicare and all the medical system is for the last 3 months of life. And if we just learned to go into palliative care and go into a hospice, you'd save a bundle and you would die much happier and better. Not isolated in a intensive care unit, but with your loved ones, with your kids and family, and singing hymns and doing all this good stuff. And just the other day, a woman said, she's 93, I want to die with my grandchildren feeding me lemon jello. Instead, they put her in the IC unit and spent $342,000 in 28 days. And she wanted to die with the jello. Now, that's unfortunate. If that is modern medicine, then obviously the public is choosing to go the other way, is to go back to whole person healing. Mentioning, there's a very, very nice book by George Leonard, who was the editor of Look, and it was all about the fact, the silent wave or something, and that the whole of our life is bathed in radiation, in pulses, in vibrations, right? We have acoustic vibrations, which we can feel. We have electromagnetic vibrations. We have all kinds of sound and light, basically, which bathe us and which affect us, every single part of us. And we've really missed out. And that is why bells have such a profound effect. Andy Weil goes to India, hears the bells in a temple and knows something. That is why chanting, that is why saying Om is so important. That is why all the new devices couple the human beings in brain waves, right? The brain waves are alpha waves and theta waves and all those things at 8 hertz and 12 hertz and 40 hertz. We know that now because we, as a human species, evolved in a certain radiation. The world is bathed in a radiation of about 8 hertz, which comes from the ionosphere to the, because the lightning strikes and all that stuff. We, whether we like it or not, you're being bombarded with 8 hertz radiation. So now, if your brain waves pick up and always seem to have mimic that 8 hertz or some multiple thereof, some harmonic thereof, heterodyne thereof, that is, seems to be what the brain does. So the new devices are all learning to exploit that. They entrain the brain waves to mix with certain vibrations. And then you are able to cause decrease in pain in a certain sequence. So it's the repetition that sets the cycling. And which frequencies and which radiation? Do you use acoustic radiation, sound waves, or do you use electromagnetic radiation? Or you, do you just use a field? And do you use the rise time of the field? So we are seeing the biophysics of the interaction of the human system. That's the right word now, because I am a very complex system with these fields, acoustic radiation, electromagnetic fields, whatever it is really where the action is going to be. It isn't actually going to, it is there. That's why we've been doing it. And how the most interesting and far out question is, how does spiritual healing take place? What is the vector? And we say these are kind of a intention. I intend that you get better. And it looks like I send out some signal. Now, is that a real signal? Or is it in some kind of new space? But I think what I'm intrigued at as a scientist is, there's absolutely zero doubt that these things take place. That is what we should be looking at. It is cheap, it is free, it's nothing to, and that is also its downfall. The interesting part is that when money gets involved, maybe making a livelihood is one thing, but grabbing money is another. When people want to get rich out of healing, it screws it up badly. So I think that the most exciting part right now is understanding, although I think not even understanding, I think getting this word out that many more people can use it. That's more important than doing research to understand it. Hippocrates said, it is more, to the doctors, it is more important to know the person who has the disease than the disease that the person has. We try to study the bejabbers out of the disease. X, Y, Z test, $100,000 on testing. Literally, on testing, before we do anything. Hippocrates said, oh, listen to the person. Tell me your story. How's your wife doing? Did the kids give you a hard time? What's your neighbor saying? All those factors shape your bodily responses too. So Hippocrates was very wise, and we should spend much more time on the whole person.
Take us here, and you take us there.